Welcome everybody. How's everyone doing? Let's get ready to worship the Lord together. Created from dust. Walked in our pain, now you're taking us higher. You stepped into time. You laid down your life to save us. You took all our shame. On the cross it was laid. Higher.
We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same. We go from glory to glory to glory. We're forever changed, forever changed.
Brought into your endless kingdom. By the blood I was made, no longer a slave. Now you're taking us higher, cause
we go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same.
On the grave.
Yes, you did.
So not even death can shake us. The victor has won, and heaven has come. And now you're taking us higher. Sing that.
And now you're taking us higher. We go from glory.
Forever change.
the grave. So not even death can shake us. The victor has won. Heaven has come. Now you're taking us higher.
Now you're taking us higher. We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same. We'll never be the same. You take us higher and higher and higher. We're forever changed. We're forever changed. 'Cause we go from glory.
Would you just lift your voice unto him right now? Come on, let's just magnify him right now. Let's just worship him right now. Oh, I love you, Jesus. I praise you, Jesus. Come on, I magnify you, Lord. How wonderful and how great and how excellent thou art. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We praise your holy name. We worship your mighty God. We praise you, great I am. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for being here tonight. They're going to sing this one more time. Would you reach into your billfolds, into your purses, wherever you keep your offering? And why don't we bring our tithes and let's bring our offerings right now as they begin to sing. Would you do it?
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God.
A great big hand clap of praise right now. Come on, somebody praise him right now. Oh, somebody magnify him right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated. I'm so glad that each and every one of you are in the house of the Lord tonight. Angi is getting ready to come, and she is going to bring the word of the Lord to us. I do want to just remind you that Sunday is a special day, and it's Father's Day. And so we are going to be honoring our fathers. I trust and pray that you will be here. I do also want to let you know that my family is leaving as soon as Sunday morning is over with, and we will be gone for a couple of weeks. And so church will continue to roll right along. I don't know if that's your phone. That's that. There we go. So we will be on vacation for the next couple weeks. But Pastor Tommy will be in here, and he will be preaching, minister. And we're believing God to do some great and some mighty things. If you cannot get a hold of me, of course, you can reach out to Bobby Slayton, Nick Slayton. Also, you can reach out to Pastor Tommy. All of those men will be able to help you in any situation that you're in. Of course, all of you have my cell number, and so I'm just a flight away if you need me really bad. And so we're going to see God do some great things tonight and then Sunday. How many's looking forward to hearing from the word of the Lord tonight? Yeah. Amen. All right.
Hello, everyone. Going to need to grab your Bibles. Hopefully you bring them to church. You have no greater possession. Grab some notes. I'm going to give you a lot of scripture. So why don't you put your hand on your head. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. Now here's my mind. I pray that you would anoint my mind to receive your word. Let it go to the depths of my soul. Let it spring forth fruit. God, I pray that there would be nothing said out of offense, but that what comes forth, God, encourages, lifts up, strengthens, convicts, and moves us closer to the throne room of you, Lord. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. How many of you know that the Lord is good? A few? Now, if you answer, don't answer. How many of you know that the Lord is good?
Yeah.
How many of you know that the Lord is good?
Yeah.
How many of you want to go to heaven?
Yeah.
How many of you want to stay here on earth? How many of you want to go to hell? How many want to go to heaven?
Amen.
What seven words do you want to hear? Did you realize there's also a different set of seven words? Go to Matthew chapter 7, 21 to 23. It's going to be on the screen for you. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Verse 23 in the New Living Translation says that I will reply, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's law. Now, I want to ask you, how many of you want to break God's law? I don't see any hands. How many of you want to keep his commandments? John 14, 15 to 21 says, if you love me, this is the words of Jesus. If you love me, you already know what it says. What does it say? And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. That's the people who are not believers. He says, but you know him because he lives with you now and later will be in you. No, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you also will live. When I am raised to life again, you will know that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. Would you just read that verse with me? Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones, and because they love me, my Father will love them, and I will love them and reveal myself to each of them. This is what Jesus is talking to his disciples about and to the people that are around. He goes on to say in verse 23 and 24 that anyone who loves him will do what he says, and anyone that does not love him will not obey him. So would you agree with me that our lifestyle and how we live tells God whether we love him or we don't? Because if we love him, we will do what? And if we don't love him, we will do what? We will disobey if we don't love him. It says we will not obey him if we don't love him. So we can say we love God, but if we disobey his word, we don't love him. That's what Jesus said. Now, I don't know if any of you are big enough to tell Jesus that he's not telling the truth, but I'm sure not. If Jesus told me that if I don't obey him, I don't love him, I'm going to believe that my lifestyle should prove that I love him. So do you believe that every word in the Bible is true? Am I talking to believers? Genesis to Revelation. You believe it. If you have your Bible, would you just raise your Bible? All right, if you're using your phone as your Bible, just raise that. Now, if you believe that every word is true, would you just say, I believe it's true?
I believe it's true.
All right, whether or not you believe it doesn't matter, because it is. It is true. Matthew 24, 35 says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words shall never pass away. His word doesn't expire just because philosophy, viewpoints, modern age, or civilization advances or changes. We live in an ever-changing world, but God's word never changes. Every promise he spoke, he's going to bring to pass. Do you believe that?
Yes.
And every command he spoke, he expects us to keep it. Do you believe that? God has let us know over and over again in his word that trouble and hard times are going to come. Has anyone experienced some trouble or hard times? It's going to come, but he said he'll never leave us, he'll never forsake us, he'll never quit loving us, he'll never give up on us, and he will never let go. But he also expects us to never leave him, never give up, never let go of his hand guiding us. This isn't a one-way relationship. He's holding us, but I got to hold on to him. He's going to love us no matter what, because Romans tells us that nothing can separate us from the love of God. But what's going to prove that I love him is if I obey his commandments. Many of you know that the epistles are the letters to the church. From Romans to Jude, those are letters written to the churches. And many of you might know, and if you don't, here's you some Bible help today. But the epistles, there's also three of them that are called the pastoral epistles. That's 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus. These are letters that theologians say that these letters were towards the end of Paul's life. He was kind of getting older at this time, and some of them he wrote while he was in prison, and he was concerned about his successors that were coming after him, especially the young ones. And so the letters concern the things that would be crucial for pastors to understand, such as church organization and discipline, opposition or rebellious members or false teachers, and the maintenance of doctrinal purity. So Paul is writing these three epistles, 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus, to the pastors for the churches. When you get to 2nd Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 4 is what we're going to read. One preacher said the pastoral epistles are the how-to manual for pastors in all places and for all times. 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 4, it says, "You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God." Do you believe we are living in the last days? Did you see anybody you know in there? We're in there too. Because all of us battle loving ourself and our pleasures even more than the things of God. Verse 4 in the King James Version says, "Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure, more than lovers of God." These characteristics all have one thing in common, and it's what Pastor talked about Sunday at the very end, is self. We are traitors because of self. We are headstrong because of self. We are haughty because of self. We are lovers of pleasures rather than lovers of God, all because of ourselves. So why don't you just pinch your flesh right now? And why don't you just tell yourself, this flesh is in enmity with God. Your flesh doesn't want to live for God. Your flesh doesn't want to receive God's word. Your flesh doesn't want to be corrected by God's word. Your flesh wants to do what you want to do. That is the day and the time we are living in, even more so than when Paul was writing this to Timothy. This attitude also marks the current age that we live in. Here's some examples for all of you that are millennials. You might not know some of these, but for those of you who were around in the 90s, here's some advertising slogans, and tell me if you know which one they are. "Life is a game, drink it up." Gatorade. "Be your own rock." Prudential Insurance. "Sometimes you gotta break the rules." That was before Burger King said, "Have it your way." "Nothing is taboo, break all the rules." And for all of those who are wanting to drink now, Don Q Rum said that. "Our shoe conforms to your foot, so you don't have to conform to anything." Easy Spirit Shoes said that. "Your world should know no boundaries." Merle Lynch said that. "Relax, no rules here," Neiman Marcus. Just do it. Yeah, y'all know Nike. And then I've never heard of this clothing company, and I don't even know if they're still around because I tried to Google them. But their slogan was resist much, obey little. Code West Clothes. That was their slogan. So from cars to hamburgers, shoes to investment firms, clothes to department stores, alcohol to sports drinks, the theme of accountability is what is being said. No one wants accountability, even today in this age. These were just slogans in the 90s, yet today the message is still the same. You make your own rules. You answer to no one. You are the one that matters. Your universe revolves around you. That is the world you and I live in today. God is not against pleasure. So many people think that church, living for God, has to be boring because he doesn't like pleasure. Who do you think gave us everything? It was God. He loves pleasure. We don't have to choose between pleasure and God because when you serve God, there are pleasures. Psalm 16:11 says, "Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand are pleasures forevermore." You won't do one thing in this world that is pleasurable that will last. But serving Christ is pleasures forevermore. However, we do have to choose between the love of pleasure and the love of God. Living for God will give us many pleasures, but they only come as we love God first and we refuse to do the pleasures of our flesh. Verse 5 in 2 Timothy says, "They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly." Stay away from people like that. Now remember, he's talking to the church. He's not talking to the unbelievers. And we're living in a day that people want a salad bar religion. They want to pick what they like, leave what they don't like, come back for more of the blessings that they like, and still leave all the responsibilities. People want to feel free to be spiritual, but they want no sense of obligation to be biblical. And that is even happening in the church world. Not just the unchurched world is living this way. The church world is living this way. The power of godliness that men will despise in the last days is the power that should guide our lives. People don't want God's power to guide our lives. We want God's power to bless us. But we don't want his power to guide our lives. Many people today want God to tell them what they're doing is okay. When we're all self-absorbed, we want God to bless it, and we will look for a church, we will look for a friend, we will look for a pastor, we will look for a small group, we will look for somewhere that tells us that it's okay to think about myself only. But if we read the word, we will never find that. In Titus chapter 2, Paul promotes right teaching and lifestyle, and in Titus chapter 2, every single person in this room is in there, because he's talking to the older men and to the older women, how they should live and how they should train. He's talking to the young women and to the young men. And then he's talking to the employees, which calls them slaves, but how we should handle our jobs. When you get to verse 11 to 15, it says, "For the grace of God has been revealed, bringing salvation to a few people." To how many? Grace brings salvation. You don't go out and get saved. Grace saved us. Grace saved us from our mess and all of our problems. Grace saved us from what we actually deserved. Grace comes to us, and we have the opportunity to receive grace. There's one gospel and one grace for all men. We are living in, I've been off media, so if you, I just had to get off because it just put me in a foul mood to see all the fear being pushed along with COVID, and now to see all the rioting. Grace is for all people. It's for the red, yellow, black, and white. It's for the Democrat, the liberal, the conservative, the Republican, the independent. It's for the rich, for the poor, for the beautiful, for the ugly, for the old, for the young, for the male, for female. It's for every person. That is what grace is for, and the gospel. And so God doesn't have a gospel of grace for some and a gospel of law or self-justification for others. All mankind finds salvation in the grace of God. If you want to be saved from your own self, you will have to find the grace of God. Now, you have to receive it because he found you. You won't find him, but you have to receive his grace. Verse 12 says, we are instructed, this is you and I, we are instructed to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures. We should live in this evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God. So I want to just break that down in case that wasn't clear enough, but I think it is. But if you are a believer in Christ, if you've been filled with his Spirit, you have been instructed to turn from godless living. Godless living is doing anything that God's not the center of. Godless living is being self-absorbed, self-righteous, self-condemning. Whatever self might be, that is godless living. We should live in this evil world. He said we're in an evil world. And evil is not just some things that we want to call evil, like a really, really bad sin. Evil is anything that goes against God's word. Gossiping can be considered evil, not just the big sins. Self-righteousness can be considered evil, not just the big sins. So he said, while you live in this world, you must live with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God. While we look forward with hope, I'm not so sure that there's that many church people these days that are looking forward. If you talk to a lot of people, there's a lot of negativity. I don't know how many are looking forward. We need to look forward with hope to that wonderful day when the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, will be revealed. Verse 14 says, he gave his life to free us from every kind of sin. Whatever sin that you battle, he came to free you. I don't care what your sin is. I don't care. There's not a big enough sin that God can't free. He came to free us from every kind of sin. He came to cleanse us and to make us his very own people, totally committed to do good deeds. I don't serve God, or rather, I don't serve and work for God because I'm trying to be saved. But because he has saved me, it causes me to want to serve him and to be involved in his kingdom. It causes me to want to do good deeds. Verse 15 says, you must teach these things. He's talking to the pastor. He's talking to Timothy. You must teach these things and encourage the believers to do them. You have the authority to correct them when necessary, so don't let anyone disregard what you say. Grace is a teacher. Grace makes ethical demands and instructs us as Christians to live our lives according to God's word. Not according to what I want, but according to his word. Grace puts ungodliness and worldly lust in our past. Because he has saved me, I don't keep doing what I've always done. If I was hateful before he saved me, I should not be hateful now. If I was an adulterer before, I should not be an adulterer now. If I was a fornicator before, I should not be a fornicator now. If I was angry before, I shouldn't live in anger now. If I was a gossiper before, I shouldn't be a gossiper now. Grace frees me from that. Now grace teaches us to forsake those things and to avoid them. Not just put them in the past, but to leave them behind and never to go back to them. One theologian, he wrote this. Grace teaches us how to live in the present age. We must live soberly with self-control in regard to ourselves. We must live righteously in regard to the people around us. And we must live godly, taking God seriously in regard to our God. So it's one thing to say we're godly, but if we're not taking God serious, I don't know if we would be godly. Grace teaches us to accept and to expect and to prepare for our blessed hope. Grace teaches us that hope is not heaven or glory, but Jesus himself face to face. We just sung that song, and would you give it up for Livy? I mean, do y'all see Livy up here playing? There she is. Grace helps us to look forward to see Jesus. We were just singing about being around the throne room, crying, holy, holy, holy. I don't want to put a damper on this, but if you can't worship here, if you can't block everything out in one service and just worship with the body of Christ and sing, holy, 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 I'm not for sure you're going to know what to do if you even make it to heaven. Because all we're going to do is sing the praises of God. We're not going to be self-absorbed there. We're not going to be thinking about our agendas tomorrow. We're not going to be thinking about what we did wrong or what we need to do or anything else. We're going to be thinking about and praising God the whole time. Grace teaches us to expect that blessed hope. A commentary that I read recorded, looking for, such as looking for what the scripture says, indicates that Christians should live in an active expectation of the return of Jesus. It should be so precious to Christians. We should live in expectation. Now, you don't have to answer and raise your hand, but how many today have gone already that you have not even thought about expecting him to come today? We've been so caught up in work and busyness and life and kids and going on vacation or coming back from vacation or trying to get this taken care of or that taken care of. We, as the body of Christ, should be looking forward. When you're engaged, I don't think we have anybody at this moment engaged in this church, but when you get engaged, both male and female are looking forward to being married. They're looking for that day. They count down the days, like 300 days till we marry, or 30 days till we marry, or sometimes they'll get down to 17 hours before I say I do. That's because they're looking forward to what they're about to become a part of. We should be looking forward for the return of Christ. Amen. He said this, he said, Christians ought to consider this, that he came the first time to save the soul of man, and he will come a second time to resurrect the body. He came the first time to save the individual, and he's going to come a second time to save a society. He came the first time to a crucifixion, he will come a second time to a coronation. He came the first time to a tree, he will come a second time to a throne. He came the first time in humility, he will come a second time in glory. He came the first time and was judged by men, he will come a second time to judge all men. He came the first time and he stood before Pilate, he will come a second time and Pilate will stand before him. That's the Savior you live for. Charles Spurgeon said that the discipline of grace, according to the apostle, has three results: denying, living, and looking. You see all the words right there before you. We got to deny ourselves, we got to live for him, and we got to look for him. It's not that hard to follow Christ. Jesus Christ redeemed us, and that means he bought us by paying his life as our ransom. He gave all for us, and he's expecting us to give all to him. When we live his way, we not only experience his grace, peace, joy, righteousness here on earth, but we're guaranteed to spend eternity with him forever. Now, who wants to spend eternity with him?
Amen.
I know that if, I don't know, what are some sports players? Call me out a name. What's a sports player? Tom Brady. If Tom Brady walked in here, I know some people would be awestruck. I know some people would be clapping. I know if another sports player or a celebrity or somebody walked in this place, your attention would be taken. But when we're talking about Christ, looking forward to Christ, I got so many eyes just staring at me like, when are you going to be done at 7:45? I'm talking about eternity for you. The word hallelujah in Revelation 19 is used in heaven, where a great multitude has gathered before the throne in the immediate presence of God himself. It's the wedding supper of the Lamb. It's what you're living for to go there. The enemies of God have been overthrown and the gospel has triumphed. In a victory celebration, all heaven renders praise. A song of thanksgiving is uttered by a holy being all around the throne. And we're going to read Revelation chapter 19. I'm only going to read verse 1 and then 5, 6, and 7. And John is saying, after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, hallelujah, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. And verse 5 says, and a voice came out of the throne saying, praise our God, all ye servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. Verse 6, and I heard as it were the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of the mighty thundering, saying, alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. How many of you are ready to say that? Yeah. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife, that's the bride of Christ, his wife hath made herself ready. If you're not ready, you're not going to be there. But if you're ready, you're looking for it. So I'm not going to stand here tonight to try to oppress you or leave you feeling like you can't make it. But I am coming to try to sound an alarm to tell you we cannot go backwards.
That's right.
We can't go back to the life that we were freed from.
That's right.
We cannot keep living as if things are not really eternal.
Right.
We are making permanent decisions. On temporary situations.
That's the truth.
God came to redeem us.
Right.
And I've never met one person who he came to redeem that when they went backwards, they overcame.
Right.
There's only one direction to go if you're a believer in Christ. Forward. Right. Forward and upward. That's it. Because if we go backward, you won't stop. Some people go backward for a little bit thinking that they're going to stop, but you won't stop. You will keep flowing with the current.
That's
Christ called us to redeem us. We can make it. I don't care what you've gone through. I know COVID sent a lot of people in a mess. But we can make it. We can overcome. Your marriage can overcome. Your children can be saved. Your life can turn around. Oppression, depression, anxiety, fear, addiction, all these things that we are battling can be released. But you will have to be intentional. It won't happen with you not doing anything about it. We are the bride of Christ, and he's coming back for a bride that's looking for him, and a bride without spot or blemish. Self-absorbed, self-centeredness, selfishness, and even self-righteousness. These things are spots and blemishes that will stain our lives if they're not dealt with. I think many times that we forget where God's brought us and what he has saved us from. And I wanted you to look at Galatians chapter 5. And I think it might be verse 19. Let's go up to 16. It says, so I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. When we crave the things that come from this world, that's our sinful nature. So he said, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Remember, he's talking to the church. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. I got to look this way. I can't see that. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other. So you are not free to carry out your good intentions. If you wonder why you're struggling to live for God, it's because your sinful nature is at a war with the Spirit of God.
That's right.
The Bible says our flesh is enmity. There are days that I wake up and I want to pray. There are days I wake up and I want to do good and I want to submit my flesh. And there are days that I wake up, and a lot of times those days have been after like my longest prayer shift or after I feel like I've just had a victory, I have woke up and I did not feel like praying. And I did not feel like doing good. And I did not feel like serving. And I didn't even feel like even doing anything for God that day. Maturity, spiritual maturity, I didn't stay there. I did it anyway. You can't walk by feelings. The scripture says we walk by faith, not by sight. But you also can't walk by feelings. You got to walk by discipline. The discipline of wanting to make the right choice. Verse 18. But when you are directed by the Spirit, you are not under obligation to the law of Moses. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality. This is fornication and adultery. Premarital sex. Pornography, any kind of sexual impurity. I don't know why all of a sudden the church has had to be okay with fornicating. It's still a sin to God. All right, I'll move on. You didn't like that one. Impurity, pornography is still a sin to God. Okay, let's move on. Lustful pleasures, that's anything that our lust desires. This isn't just all, even self-righteous people have lust. Okay? We either want so much more money, so much more vanity, so much more fashion, so many more friends, more popularity, anything that's lustful. Idolatry. Every single person in this room battles idolatry. Sorcery. Maybe we don't have witchcraft. That's good. Hostility. We have a lot of anger here, a lot of quarreling, a lot of jealousy, outbursts of anger. Selfish ambition. We have a lot of only do what we do. Dissension, division. Verse 21, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. That wasn't even the whole list. He just finally said, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, Paul said, as I have before, that anyone, would you read this with me? Anyone living that sort of life. So I want to ask you, do you want to inherit the kingdom of God? We can't be in that scripture then. And the one that we really all fall under is idolatry. Idolatry gets all of us because you can be so self-absorbed with your own self. We can be fearful and make that idolatry, because when we are so fearful that we can't even turn our trust to God, that becomes idolatry. When we are so anxious that we depend on something to calm us down, that's idolatry. When we are, I'm not talking about seasons where we might need some help with some medicine to get us back on balance. Please don't think I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about anything that we give the same effort or even more effort to God is idolatry. We can't hardly do certain things because we're so self-absorbed. Try to put that up there one more time. I'm sorry. Envy, drunkenness, wild parties, other sins like these, let me tell you again, if you do these things. Now, if you've done them, you can repent. That's grace. But we don't keep going back to that. We got to turn from that. And I'm just going to just call it out. I didn't know that the church world, somebody sent me an article. I didn't know that there was such a high percentage of pastors who think drinking's okay. I didn't know that there was such a high number of the church people. And here's what I'm trying to say. People are trying to make heaven and hell out of everything.
Right.
From what I wear, to where I go, to what I do, to how I do this, are everything. People are trying to make heaven and hell out of everything. And if heaven and hell is your question on everything, you're asking the wrong question. The question ought to be, does this bring me closer to Christ or does this pull me further away? I only have one mission and agenda up here tonight. One. And that is, if you have moved farther away from Christ than to him, my mission is to pull you back. Not to crucify you. Not to make you feel down on yourself, but to pull you back. God didn't call his people to go backwards. And I have yet to find one person, not one, who has gone back to any way of their old living, and in that they have come closer to Christ. It doesn't happen. I have to intentionally make myself put my flesh under subjection. I quit a long time ago because I used to be a black and white person. It all had to be black and white. It was heaven or it was hell. And what was the big deal if it wasn't? Now that's not my question. Now my question is, does this pull me closer to Christ or does this pull me away? Idolatry is creeping into the church world because people think, well, we don't have these gold graven images, so we don't have idolatry. But we do. We have idolatry because we are so moved on our own from young to old. We have elders that don't want to mentor or disciple or teach or love. We have young people who don't want to obey or submit. We have all the in-between who are so wrapped up in their own self. And then you let the pastoral staff say anything, and it tightens up. Sunday it tightened up just because Pastor said we need to put the bottle down. I don't see anybody drinking out of the bottle that's getting closer to Christ. And it tightened up because God forbid for me to go to a church where somebody tells me I shouldn't live a certain way. I talk about self-righteousness because either you're drinking or you're self-righteous. It doesn't matter which end you go on, they're both wrong. because I got self-righteous people in this church griping at me because some of the other people aren't doing what I feel the Bible does teach. I'm not the policeman. I'm not the dictator. So for those of you who obey everything, stop looking at Pastor and I like it's our fault that everybody else is going crazy. It's not. It's up to you to get this word. He said nothing, no one, no one, not a pastor, not an elder, and not a young person. No one can do any of these things and enter the kingdom of heaven. And I'm going to go a little further. This, whether it's heaven or hell to drink one glass or to get drunk, that shouldn't even be your question. Your question should be, am I closer to God? And I'm not seeing anyone get closer to God. And then when we say something, you, if you're guilty, get offended, get tight, and most likely might change church. But we've had to tell you, we're not for sale. You have one life to live, one. You don't get a second chance. You don't know when your end will be. It could be tomorrow. It could be 2 years from now. He could come in the rapture in 20 days. We don't really know because we need to be looking forward. But it is an evident problem that the Life Church is in a struggle for spiritual survival. We haven't been called to be like anyone else or anything else. This isn't a competition with another church. I am just trying to wake you up and sound an alarm. Do you want the kingdom of God?
Right.
You can't feed your flesh and think you're going to get the kingdom of God. We can, everything we do goes back to self. What makes me feel good, that's why I'm going to do it. Well, I like this, that's why I'm going to do it. Well, you, pastor can't tell me what to do. You're right. I can't. We're not even trying to tell you what to do, but I am telling you, you will not stand before God and not say that you didn't hear it loud and clear, that self-righteousness and every sin and idolatry and not being a disciple, I don't know how we're going to make heaven, even if you don't do anything wrong. If you're not discipling, how are we going to make heaven? Jesus Christ gave his life for you. For you. And all he's asked you to do is give your life back to him. And the way that we do that is we disciple others. I become a disciple of Jesus Christ. I follow his teachings. And when I do it, then I start leading others to him. Church was never meant to be a pressure to you. Church is the bride of Christ. But I do want to sound an alarm. If you think that you can live for God with all and still feed yourself, that's where we mess up. It's hard to live for God when you live with one foot in and one foot out. But when you live all the way for Christ, it's not hard. I do. He says there's pleasures of sin. The Bible talks about the sinful pleasures. He's not saying that there's not fun doing your own thing. But either you're living for yourself or you're living for Christ, but you can't live for both. And when I laid down my life to Jesus Christ, I can't pick my life back up and start doing what I want to do. Turning backwards, that's spiritual apostasy. We go back to what he's called us from. People start making decisions slowly without thinking because you see somebody else doing it or you think it's not a big deal or you maybe quit praying and quit letting God convict you. Conviction's not a bad word.
No.
You should have more convictions the longer you live for Christ because that means the longer you live for him, the less you're like the world.
Right.
And I'm going to say this lastly before I move on. If being like the world was going to let the church grow, then this church should have exploded by now. But your friends don't respect you. You say one thing here, you do another thing out there. You're no different than them. You don't even offer anything different. That's whether you're doing things you shouldn't do or whether you're not doing what you should do. We sin both ways. Some people in this room are sinning by commission. You're doing it. Some people are sinning in this room by omission. You're not doing what you should. So how can I win people if I'm not discipling like I should, if I'm not loving the gospel like I should? When we talk about the gospel, it ought to be the thing that excites every person in this room.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Because the gospel is what saved us. His death, his burial, and his resurrection is what saved us. There's a song. It says, when I think about the Lord and what he's done for me. Any of you know that song? If I could sing, I would have just had them play it, and I'd have sung it for you. It's been on repeat because it's come back to my mind in the last couple weeks. But when I think about the Lord and what he's done for me, how he saved me, how he healed me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about what he's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. Revelation talks about standing around the throne, and they're singing hallelujah. How many of you want to stand around his throne? I don't know when that's going to be. I know I'm 49. I've heard it my whole life. But it is going to happen. Every word will pass. The Bible says a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. So he's only been gone a couple days according to his time frame. According to ours, it's been a long time, but not according to his. And he is coming back, and he wants you to be ready. And right now, he's a merciful God. But don't forget, he is a holy God. And he doesn't inhabit where there's sin. And sometimes we're in these services. I'm trying to watch it, because if this is on Facebook, for people who don't go to this church, they can take and just mess this all up. But for the Life Church, you're in a spiritual battle. Every family that I know has got something going on. And the answer.